Come to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 16 to 26. The second part of that chapter we will read responsively. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 16 to 26. We will read responsively. Rundava Timothy Krasna Patrika, Rundava Dhyayamu, Padahara Vachnam Ninchi, Irvai Aro Vachnam Varku. Uttara Pratyuttaram Chadukunam. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doeth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying, that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having the seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Verses 22. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing, verse 25, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Let us pray and look to the Lord. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you for this immense privilege you give to us this Lord's Day, as we come around your precious word, as we desire to be spoken by thee. Lord, we give our hearts, our ears, Lord, our lives, Lord, to the preaching and the teaching of your word, that your word may have its full course. Lord, that your word might be released onto our lives, that it would bring forth the due fruit, and Lord, that your word would enable us and edify us to be the kind of people you have called us to be. Lord, as we desire that, Lord, you through your Spirit might speak to every individual, every one of us this evening here, Lord, in your presence, as we humble ourselves, Lord, I ask that you would hide me and speak through me, to me, to each one of us. And Lord, may your word be exalted, Lord, not just in our hearing, but also in our living, to such an extent, dear Father, that you would draw many to your fold through our lives as well. We ask that you would bless this time. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. As we come to the second section of this second chapter of 2 Timothy, we really would come to where we can really relate to what Paul is trying to say. So far it's been at a very higher plane of what Paul is calling, and more often we would assume that it is for the great evangelists or the so-called great servants of God who are only called to be enduring afflictions for the sake of the gospel. Because that is essentially the theme of this letter, that Paul, as a last words of encouragement, Paul is giving to Timothy, saying that if there is anything that he would want Timothy to have his heart be gripped onto, it is that he should not take this high calling that God is giving to grab onto the opportunity to endure afflictions for the gospel. That is what Paul was trying to do as a last effort to get Timothy to have his passions, his vision, to be gripped to this truth that he should take every opportunity, he should snatch every opportunity to count it as a privilege to endure afflictions for the gospel. Now, yes, in our lives, in a comfortable living of society that we live in the church settings, and in America that we live in, where there is freedom, you and I might not be able to completely relate to it, because our lives are filled with so much of coziness, our lives are filled with such freedoms, so much so that this might seem a bit more alien. But to this section as we come, we would really be able to appropriate it, because this is fundamental and essential to the higher calling that Paul was already talking about. Now, last week, after the sermon, I was talking to Brother Naveen, and he was mentioning about this section, and he also reminded me of the phrase that I have used when I preached last 2 years ago, I suppose, on the same chapter, and one sermon on this whole chapter. But this time I got more opportunity to break it down so that we could take it at a pace better than the last time. Now, I have titled this sermon, this second section of 2 Timothy chapter 2, as Sanctified Vessel. This is essentially what Paul is putting as a picture image that he wants Timothy's lives to constantly have or draw parallels to for his own life. And how is it that any one of us can exempt ourselves from not drawing parallels to such a wondrous image that Paul is putting? We will look at that image and this portrait that Paul puts it in between the two sections. So this whole reading that we did can be broken down into three simple sections. I'll help us understand that sections, but I want to have us take note that what it is to be a sanctified vessel, a sanctified vessel. And as individuals that we are, God has made us to be vessels. And in fact, in 2 Corinthians, Paul was writing to the Corinthian church, and he says this in verse 7. He says, we are the earthen vessels, or the jars of clay. We are made out of the dust, as Adam, when he was made, Adam, the Hebrew word, is a similitude of something carved or made out of dust. That's what we are in the genealogy and the generations of Adam that we all come from. We all have been made out of this ground and dust that we are. And that's why it's rightly Paul puts it in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 7. He says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And that is a picture of a born-again child of God who has the gospel as a treasure in the heart, that the earthen vessel that we are. Although he or she, as a born-again child of God, has not become a golden vessel. We would want to think about ourselves as golden vessel, right? But we are still in this earthen container called these bodies that we live in. Now, in that same note, Paul is giving about these vessels in a great house. We will come to that. But let me bring to us the outline of this section. So Paul begins in verse 16. He is talking about, firstly, a note on false teachers and false teachers' attributes and characteristics of false teaching. In verses 16 to 19, he labors to communicate, and also one point in verses 22 also. I'll touch upon it. There are seven preventions, seven negations that Paul is going to put there as to what are the characteristics, what are the attributes of a false teacher. Now, this is vitally important for not just Timothy, but also for our lives. What is false teaching? I happened to come across a Q&A session where a man of God was asked this question. Who are we to consider as false teachers? And then it's a very good question to be asked. And what is false teaching that we need to be careful from? So we will look at that seven negations, seven preventions in teaching that Timothy is being called by Paul, and even in our lives as it trickles down, what we need to be guarding ourselves from. It's not that we should be exposed to any teaching in the name of Christendom, in the name of church preaching and teaching. You and I are not to just let ourselves loose in being taught whatever any church would teach or any so-called preacher would preach. We are called to be negating such teaching. We are called to be preventing from bringing our lives under such teaching. And that's a dangerous thing that end times would bring. Because in chapter 3, he says in verse 3, he talks about how in end times, especially, we can make ourselves preachers or teachers because of itching ears, it seems. If we are not careful, you and I can go about searching for teachers who can just teach what we want to hear rather than what God wants us to hear. And so that's why we need to guard ourselves, negate ourselves, prevent ourselves from bringing our lives under such teaching. That's how it will apply to us. If it for Timothy and some of us who preach and teach, we ought to be guarding ourselves from these characteristics or attributes of false teachers. Not that we are false teachers, but there are these things that we need to be careful and mindful in all our learnings as well. Now, the second section, verses 20, 21, apart from a false teacher's attributes in the first section, Paul is giving an analogy of vessels in a great house. We'll see that. And thirdly, he is giving a characteristic or the possessions of a true servant of God. From verses 22 to the last, he talks about a list of attributes of a true servant of God. Now we will look at these three sections, but let me begin that the first section contains seven preventions, seven negations, and in the last section about a true servant of God, I could identify about eight, but we would see that there are nine possessions that a true servant of God is being called to. We will look at that, nine possessions and seven negations. And in between that is this process of us being made as sanctified vessels. We will look at that. So let's go one verse at a time, and I'll highlight only a few things that we need to take note. So from verse 16, take note of that introductory word. See, the verse begins, but. You know, this is a conjunction of a contrast that he is bringing. In the first section of 2 Timothy, Paul was trying to give positive motivations, or he's giving some motivations as to why Timothy need to endure afflictions for the gospel. There were seven high callings that he touched on. How God is calling Timothy to be a good soldier of the great king. He is calling to be the great servant, or a good servant, or a faithful servant of the Lord of Lords that he is. And then we looked at all the seven callings, like a sportsman, like a sower, like a sufferer, and like a son, and finally, like a student of God's word, a good student. He need to take his calling seriously. And that would result in enduring afflictions for the gospel. Those are all seven motivations that he's given. Now he's coming to the seven negations. And so that's why he begins with but. In a sense, he's contrasting. If those are the motivations, let me give you the negations. And he begins by saying, but shun profane and vain babblings. Here, these are all the negative things that he needs to be guarding himself from. In fact, the tone begins in verse 14 itself. He says, strive not. In verse 14, he says, put these things to remembrance. And then he says, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit. Those are some tone of negative things that Paul is bringing. But he brings in a real way from verses 16 onwards. Let me highlight seven things in a quick way. The first thing that we see is babblings of vanity and profanity in verse 16. There are these babblings of vanity and profanity that a false teacher or a false teaching would easily get into. That's the first characteristic of a false teacher or a false teaching. Now, before I go through these seven negations that I'm going to give as a list that we can keep, I want to just bring out the definition of a false teacher, that the man of God who got that question answered. And it's an interesting answer. It's a good answer. And so that's why I want to give us. A false teacher is somebody, in a simple sense, he's teaching that is something that is false, that is very obvious. He's teaching that is not true. But more importantly, a false teacher is somebody who is not teachable. When he knows, we all begin with error in our lives. We begin learning error and we begin learning in a self-centered way. We want everything to be working for us and for the benefit of us and for ourselves, rather than God-centered way. And so we begin learning all things that are good in a self-centeredness rather than God-centeredness. So we all have this baggage and this learnings from our background of what we have picked up in our upbringing. But there needs to be a teachable spirit that we need to have. Only then we will move from error to the truth. And one of the most important characteristics that the man of God was highlighting in his answer about false teacher is not that he would teach something wrong. Yes, he certainly would be teaching wrong. But when he is corrected, he would not be teachable. There is no humility in wanting to be corrected. And that is a grave danger. And not only that, the second part of the answer is somebody who would not be careful in the essentials. Augustine said it wonderfully. He said that we are called as Christians, we are called to have unity in essentials. Unity in essentials. What is essentials? Essentials about who the God is. The God of the Bible is a God who is a triune God. We can't compromise on the essentials. He's a triune God. In a simple sense, we talked about this during our Bible study with an acronym called doctrine, right? The deity of Christ. D standing for deity of Christ. O standing for original sin. C standing for the canon of the scriptures. T standing for the Trinity, that the God of the Bible reveals himself in the scriptures. R standing for regeneration. When you and I come under the gospel, it regenerates us, makes us a new creation. R standing for resurrection, N standing for T-R-I, I standing for incarnation. That is Jesus coming down as a human being in a real sense. N standing for new creation, that we are regenerated in Christ through the gospel. And E standing for eschatology, doctrine. In a simple sense, it preserves the essentials in place. Now, if somebody compromises on the essentials, you and I should run away from that teaching. And that's why Augustine says simply that we need to have unity in essentials. You cannot compromise on essentials and say you can have, oh brother, we need to be united. We cannot say anything against another brother. No, not in the essentials. Unity in essentials, diversity in non-essentials. Oh, which dress you can wear, whether white color or black color or that color, this color, which day is good, is Monday good or Sunday good? I mean, of course, there is a essential importance to the Lord's Day that the scripture gives, but more importantly, what are we regarding? Are we thinking one day is better than the other? Romans 14 talks about the non-essentials. Should I eat meat or not? What food did I take? What? So all these non-essentials, we can have diversity, but not in essentials. So Augustine says, unity in essentials, diversity in non-essentials, but charity in all. In all things, what we do as a Christian, it should be with an undercurrent of love and humility. And that's why we ought to be remembering that if somebody is a teacher who is compromising on essentials, we need to be regarding him, especially if he is not teachable, he or she can easily be, surely be kept in the bucket of false teachers. And so that we know from the definition of the scripture. Now, these are the other characteristics apart from this unteachableness or not having a teachable spirit, apart from the compromise on essentials. These are some more characteristics that we see that Paul is outlining that Timothy need to be negating in his life. These are subtle things, but as a man of God, he need to guard himself. It's so easy to have vain babbling, right? I mean, we can easily just let our mouth loose and just babble, but not so for a man of God, not so for a sanctified vessel. And that's why he says this, these are the negations from a child of God who would want to be a sanctified vessel. Let's go on. The first one I said is babblings of vanity and profanity. They're not fitting for a sanctified vessel. They're not fitting for a child of God. And in fact, another version of the translation, another translation says, worldly empty chatter. That's how it is. We read about chatterboxes, right? And more importantly, this quote that I came to think about when I thought about empty vessels. Empty vessels we have make more noise, right? I mean, they begin to just talk about themselves, or they begin to talk so much about what they know rather than what they need to know or what they can talk about others. And so we are called to be as children of God, as sanctified vessels, as man of God, as women of God. We need to be those that are negating vain and profane babblings. So first one in the list is babblings of vanity and profanity. I won't go every verse, but I'll highlight on those seven negations. The second one is in verse 18. We see those erring in the truth. The second characteristic of a false teacher is erring in the truth. There is a grave danger when truth is compromised. You know, what God has called us as a church, as vessel, you and I are called to be preservers of the truth individually, and as a church, we are called to be in 1 Timothy 3:15, God said the church of the living God is the pillar and the ground of truth. If there is any place in this world where truth can be found, truth is preached, truth is preserved, guarded, and kept as an important thing, valuable thing, it is the church of God. Nowhere else in this world you can find truth as it is found in the church of God. That's why sin is said to be sin in the church, and what is true and good is said to be good in the church. There's no need of trying to please one another. If it is sin in according to the word of God, as the Bible says, it is called to be sin. No gray areas, especially with regards to truth. So We're called to be not erring from the truth as sanctified vessels. Now, quickly, let me go on in the list. Third characteristics, third negation, apart from babblings of vanity and profanity, apart from erring in truth, thirdly, refraining to depart from iniquity. This is another clear sign of a false teacher or a false teaching. You and I, when we see somebody's attitude about iniquity, an attitude of not caring so much to refrain from it, to depart from it, you and I need to be watchful of a teacher or somebody who would teach that way. And that's why in verse 19 we read, towards the end of that verse, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." You know, a Christian life is not just about repenting and receiving forgiveness for sins, but departing from sin and being in a way that there is sanctification happening. You can never add Christ to your life and not subtract sin, right? It would not be true. There are many who just would want to add Christ to the list of everything that they have in their lives. Not so with Christ. If he is truly to come in, sin had to be left out. And so that's why we see refraining to depart from iniquity is a mark of a false teacher and a false teaching based life. Now, quickly, we'll come to these first three have been seen in this first section, but in verses 20 to 21, in the analogy also, Paul brings in some more characteristics. Let me highlight on that. In verse 20, Paul says a false teacher or a false teaching based life is characterized by a dishonoring vessel. A vessel onto dishonoring. You know, they might come under the umbrella of the community of Christianity, but they don't care as to how their life is in representing Christ. Whether it is bringing honor to God or dishonor to God is not of a concern to a false teacher. Whether it is giving glory to him might be a big concern. Whether they are recognized, honored, is of a great concern rather than a concern to see God receiving glory. And that's a dangerous place for a man of God or a child of God to be in. Dishonoring vessel is the fourth characteristic or a fourth negation. Fifthly, not purging from the above. That is, in verse 21 we see a child of God's life is characterized by a constant purging or a pruning that Christ is doing. We read in John chapter 15 that we are called to be the branches, Christ is this true vine, and if we do not bear fruit, Christ is going to prune us so that we might bring forth not just fruit, but much fruit for the glory of God. And so that's why a child of God, a man of God's life is constantly in the process of purging, that is taking out all the filth and pruning where there is cutting off all the things that are of not use. You know, there are many things that we might think they are not bad, but they might not be effective. And that is where pruning comes, where things that are not fruitful for eternity might be cut off. Purging is where filth is taken out or dross is removed. But pruning is where things that are of reducing our effectivity are going to be cut off. And so that's why we see if we are not purging or pruning, in the process of purging and pruning, then that is a mark of a false teacher. Sixthly, not fleeing from youthful lust. This is seen in verse 22, right? Flee from youthful lust. This is a command that Paul gives to Timothy. As a young pastor, he's being given this command, imperative to flee from youthfulness. We are seeing in the life of Joseph in the Sunday morning services, right? How he was wanting to have this fear of God, is this life that is lived before the face of God. Although he is in a foreign land, although he is in a place where nobody would see, his eyes could not be taken away from the face of God that he is living before. That word that is phrased in Latin is coram Deo, living right before the face of God. Christian life ought to be characterized by a life lived out right before the face of God. You and I need to learn to cultivate such a life of living before the very face of God. And so here Paul is commanding, imperative that Paul gives, flee from youthfulness. And a characteristic of a false teacher is that there is no fleeing from youthfulness, but letting pet sins continue. And they might be small sprouts that he would let them linger on to satisfy himself. And so we need to take note of that. Seventhly, in verses 23, we read, avoiding foolish and unlearned questions. That is a negative command or negation that Paul is giving. Not avoiding foolish or unlearned questions. That is, they're constantly involving in foolish and unlearned questions. So these are seven negations that we see. But let's come to the nine possessions that I have said. Those are seen in verses 22 onwards till 26. But before that, I would want to just touch a little on this analogy that Paul is giving. In verses 20, 21, Paul is giving this analogy of a great house. What is this great house? And then he's talking about two categories of vessels, right? Vessels unto honor, vessels unto dishonor. This analogy is simply that he's talking about the Christian community in general, as I was mentioning. And he says this wonderfully, that in a great house, verse 20, there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. There are only two categories that he is bringing out in this analogy. Vessels unto honor, vessels unto dishonor. And he's giving four kinds of vessels, right? Vessels of gold and silver, vessels of wood and earth. There are some vessels that bring honor to the owner, and there are some vessels that bring dishonor. And they're all there in a great house. Great in the sense we might want to assume it to be limiting to the church, but more importantly to the larger Christian community and those that would use the name of Christ. Now, the reason we can take note of this is in verse 21, Paul brings the application of that analogy in verses 21. He says, if a man therefore purge himself from these, that is, he's actually giving the analogy for verses 19, the last phrase of that verse 19. He's saying that let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Depart from iniquity. So he's giving a picture image so that we can think about what it is for somebody naming the name of Christ to depart from iniquity. And he says in verse 21, if a man therefore purge himself, that is to bring his life under constant purging, that is, to remove the dross and filth that is shown by the light of God's word and that is taught in the scripture, then he would be a vessel unto honor. And here comes our famous word, or the word that I have picked for our sermon title, sanctified and meet for master's use and prepared unto every good work. A sanctified vessel is a vessel that is purging itself. In this sense, purging himself, meaning not that he can purge himself all by himself, but there are ways that God has given where you and I can bring our lives under that purging process. That he is yielding to that purging work that God would want to be done in that individual. And how is it so? That he is negating the things that ought to be negated, and he is possessing the things that ought to be possessed. That is how we begin to be in staying, dwelling in the process of sanctification. You and I will dwell in this process through the rest of the days of our life. But you and I would never exempt ourselves and say, I am already sanctified, or I am already learned, and there is nothing more to teach, to be taught or learned. And where we take our lives to constantly guard ourselves from the negations and bring ourselves to the possessions. Now that brings me to the two things that would result. One is, we would not only be a vessel unto honor, but we would be a vessel meet for master's use. Now, we all should think in this very portrait that we are seeing of the real analogies. There are these vessels that are before us. There are these vessels such as gold that we, although it is more plating that we see a color of gold, but just imagine there is this vessels of gold on this side, and then the vessels of earthen or wood, that is clay and wood, on the other side. And if somebody who is as a guest comes in to our home, and we are going to serve them, what are the vessels that we would pick and choose? Say if the President of America is coming into our home, you try to take the best vessel to kind of serve. That is certainly important, that we would honor him with the best that we have. That is one aspect of it. But more importantly, we would take the clean vessel. As best as it is in its worth, in the gold plating that it might have, unless it is a clean vessel, there is no way that you're going to take to a guest of honor who deserves all the best. And how much more to the one who knows us through and through, to the one who sees us through and through. We are called to be a vessel purged from the things that are above, that we've looked at, the negations. And we are called to be a sanctified vessel, ready, meet for the master's use. And so in that note, we see that we are constantly called to be dwelling in the process of purging, and also dwelling and passionate about possession, possessing. That's what we would look at in verses 22 onwards. I'll come back to this in a little way in the closing, but let me highlight to us in the possessions that the Lord desires us to have. As a servant of God, a true servant of God, need to be a possessor of these things. Not just a proclaimer, not just an understander of these things. We can easily understand these words that I would list, but you and I are called to be possessors of that. In verses 22, the list begins in the second part of that verse. But follow, if we take note of the first list, those are the lists that we need to flee. The second list, the negations are the ones that we need to flee. The possessions are the ones we need to follow or pursue. If the negations are the ones that we need to prevent ourselves from, the possessions are the ones that we need to pursue after passionately. And we see the first one listed out there is follow righteousness. There are about 9 things that I would list. Only 8 things that are obvious. 9 thing is more of a meant or an implicit thing that I would highlight. The first thing that we would see is righteousness. You know, when we look at this, you and I need to be a possessor of righteousness. How is it so? There are 4 aspects of righteousness that a Christian who is born again, who comes from sin and destruction to salvation, is going to be receiving. A true born-again child of God receives this righteousness. I talked about this in the baptism classes wonderfully, describing the process of how God is working his righteousness. The first one is the planned righteousness. You know, God had seen that work of righteousness that Christ would accomplish before the foundations of the world, as we read in Revelation 13, that the Lamb of God was slain even before the foundations of the world. And that is the planned righteousness. This righteousness that is inherent, that is intrinsic in his own self, that Christ has. And that is the planned righteousness. And that righteousness is planned for you and me, those that would come into Christ. Not only he planned righteousness, secondly, he gives positional righteousness. This is at the time of justification. When you and I come to receive Jesus as our Lord and our Savior, this is exactly what would happen. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 21, we read, "For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." You know, that very moment when you and I received Christ, you and I have been declared righteous. God declares that this is my righteous son, this is my righteous daughter, to the whole world. That is called justification. This is positional righteousness after planned righteousness. And you know, these two come to us without anything that we do. But then comes the third righteousness, which is called the practical righteousness. How is that going to be ours? How is it that God would want you and I to possess that? This is living out of this positional righteousness. You and I live out the righteousness that God has given to you and me on a day-to-day basis, on a practical level. How is it that it would really happen on a day-to-day basis? Now, when you and I go to our offices or in our homes and the lives that we are living, the question that needs to be brought out in our lives is, what would Christ do if he was in my place today at my work? What would Christ do? I was talking about this in the Bible study as well. The questions that we need to ask to live out in a practical way the righteousness that we have received. See, the world is upside down in this area. The world thinks that it can live out righteousness and ask God, "God, I tried my best to live out right before you, so you declare me righteous." The world comes in a reverse way. But a Christian's life is marked and lived out in an other way, that is a godly way. That is, we come to God and God freely makes us and calls us righteous. We are made right with God. Now, when God declares us righteous, when we have been made right with God, how can I not live right before God? And that's why a Christian wants to live out of the righteousness that he has already received. That is, on a practical level, he or she is going to ask, "How will my Lord Jesus Christ live out? Because his righteousness is what I am covered with. How can I not live like that as Christ lived?" And so we begin to be possessors of that practical righteousness. And that has to be outworking itself on a day-to-day basis. And that is only possible for a true Christian who received this positional righteousness. And by the grace of God, by the help of the Holy Spirit, by his dependence on God, he or she is able to possess that practical righteousness. And you know, there is a day that is coming where there is this perfect righteousness, the fourth righteousness, where there'll be no more sin. And you and I would be just like Christ, as a sanctified vessel, reflecting the very glory and the perfection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, I'll come to the analogy of this sanctified vessel at the end, which is what I'm reserving. But let's continue to walk through the list. And you know, you'll be marveled that this list is actually the list of the fruit, the nine flavors of the fruit of the Spirit that we see in Galatians 5:22. Let's walk through the list quickly. He says, these are the nine possessions But of them, there are two which are substituted for others that you might identify. So the first one of the nine possessions that a child of God need to have is to follow righteousness first. Second, faith. This is in the list of the ninefold flavors of the fruit of the Spirit. And second is faith. Third is charity. This word charity in KJV is seen in other versions as love, right? That is the first flavor of the fruit of the Spirit. Faith, love, or charity. And fourthly, you and I are called to be the possessors of peace. And then, fifthly, pure heart. We see that in the flavor called goodness. Goodness. And then, sixthly, we see that in verse 24. Let me read 23 and 24 in this context. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. Verse 24, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle. By the way, I missed that one. Gentle there. This is the sixth one. Gentle. Unto all men apt to teach. Gentleness is one of the flavor of the fruit of the Spirit. And then patience. We see that in 24th verse. Verse 25, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So here in verse 25 we see the meekness as another ninth possession. Let me list all of them one by one. Righteousness 1, faith 2, charity 3, peace 4, and then pure heart 5, or which is for goodness. 6 is gentle, 7 is patient, 8 is meekness, and the ninth one that I missed is in an overall portrait that we see in a man of God here is that he or she ought to be self-controlled, in the sense there is no bursting out for the questions that are coming or for the strifes that somebody who is a false teacher would continue to oppose the instructions that are of truth. Instead, he or she is self-controlled. That is the ninth part, ninth flavor. Now, when we look at these, Paul is trying to give to Timothy as to not just take note of the seven preventions, negations, that he need to be guarding his life from the characteristics of a false teacher, but also he need to learn as a true servant of God how he ought to not just oppose, but rather gently desire for their conversion. You know, what do we do when we come across dealing with false teachers or dealing with somebody who is on a track to error and false teaching? One, you and I need to have gentleness, patience. And you and I need to call upon our Lord. There's a need for calling on the Lord with a pure heart, with a heart not regarding them that for their destruction, but desiring that they somehow be set free from the snares and the false teachings that they have been entrapped in. That should be our heart's desire. And that's what Paul is teaching Timothy, that he ought to be regarding his life to be possessed with these things. True characteristics of a true servant of God. True possessions of a true servant of God. That he need to be possessing these things so that by these things and by dependence on the grace of God and on the Lord himself, he would see these opposing false teachers to repent and acknowledge the truth, as we see in verse 25. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. In verse 26, he concludes and says, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. You know, the greatest danger of a false teacher is the devil can take them at his will. What a ensnarement. What a dangerous place that person is in. And so God is instructing through Paul to Timothy that he needs to be guarding himself by the second seven negations and the nine possessions that he need to be possessing, pursuing passionately so that he would be preserved. And in closing, I would want us to bring our lives and thoughts back to this sanctified vessel. You know, a woman, I read this in an article that came across in an email, and after reading from the book of Jeremiah about a potter and the clay, the vessel that is made, and also about this vessels that are there in the Bible, she happened to know a goldsmith, or a silversmith rather, I think I'm paraphrasing for goldsmith, but silversmith, who makes ornaments. And so she wanted to go see for herself practically as to how this process is, what he does. And she went and she talked to him and took an appointment and went and began to see the whole process silently, just watching. And as the silversmith is working out, she was asking some questions in between. First thing that she sees that this silver that is trying to be purified is brought under intense heat and fire, that melting that happens. And so the woman was asking, she was asking the silversmith, what are you going to do when that so-called dross silver is going through the fire? He says he doesn't take his eyes out of, away from that silver that is being refined, it seems. And she was relating that to the God of the Bible, who says, I am like a refiner. And she was thanking God that God is just like that silversmith. When we are under this intense pressure situations or in the fiery trials, God, when he's removing the dross, his eyes are focused on us, not for a moment drifting from us, just to see that it wouldn't melt out too much or beyond what it needs to. And so there is this removal of dross that happens, it seems. And apart from that, she was sitting down for the rest of the process. After that silver is made into a means whereby the dross has been removed, this silversmith is trying to mold and shape it like a vessel, it seems. And as he's molding and shaping there, as he is beating that molding it to the kind of shape and that this silversmith wants, he is working on it, it seems. And so is it with our lives. When God is shaping us as a vessel for sanctification, he's working on us. He's molding us. He's chiseling us from the things that would not honor him, and that would give the best fruit for him. And finally, the last question that the woman asked to that silversmith is, when do you think, or when do you say that this work is complete? And the silversmith smiled and said, you know, when I see my own image in that particular vessel that I'm making, that reflection of himself, he's totally satisfied and he just puts it there ready as a masterpiece that he does. And that's exactly what God is up to. When he wants to see his reflection of his glory, his attributes in our lives, removed of the dross, a vessel sanctified, set meet for master's use. May that be so, that our Lord is given full yielding, that he might make us as vessels meet for master's use, as he so longs us. Let's close our eyes and with these thoughts come around these elements. For such a sacrifice, to the length that he went to take that wrath that we deserve, to remove the dross, to make us possessors of his righteousness, to make us as vessels unto honor. We were vessels of wrath, deserving destructions, but he made us vessels of mercy, that we can receive mercy. And not just that, he is in this process of making a sanctified vessel, vessel unto honor, ready meat for Master's use, for His glory, to let His glory shine through our lives.